Today we are very excited to host a lecture with His Excellency Tsuneo Nishida, Ambassador Extraordinary and the Plenipotentiary, Permanent Mission of Japan to the United Nations. Ambassador Nishida will discuss Japan's engagement with the United Nations and its role in today's global governance. Before we start, I'd like to thank the sponsors that make corporate program possible. Global leaders, Citigroup, Deloitte, and United Airlines, and the corporate partners, Mizuho Financial Group, and WM Ross from the company LLC. We'd also like to thank our co-organizer, the Foreign Policy Association. Now it is my pleasure to introduce our opening speaker, Mr. Noel Latif. He's President and CEO of the Foreign Policy Association. Please welcome him to the podium.
Standing here this evening in the company of such seasoned diplomats as Ambassador Nishida and Ambassador Sakurai, I am reminded of a quote that was etched into one of the archways at the Yale Law School and is attributed to Oliver Wendell Holmes. Justice Holmes said, "The life of the law has not been logic, it has been experience." I think we can say the same for diplomacy, and we will benefit from hearing one of Japan's most experienced and distinguished diplomats this evening. Let me add that we are very pleased at the Foreign Policy Association to joint venture with the Japan Society. We take great interest in the subject of global governance and Japan's important and constructive role in world affairs. Now it gives me great pleasure to turn the floor over to our director at the Foreign Policy Association, Roger Blissett, who will formally introduce Ambassador Nishida. Mr. Blissett.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ambassador Sakurai, Noel, and the diplomatic corps here with us today. I am indeed delighted to preside over today's program, Japan and the United Nations in a Turbulent World. We are very fortunate to have with us as our speaker, Ambassador Tsuneo Nishida, permanent representative of Japan to the United Nations. Before his appointment as permanent representative, Ambassador Nishida served as ambassador of Japan to Canada. Over his diplomatic career, spanning 43 years, Ambassador Nishida has worked in the Japanese embassies in the former Soviet Union and in the United States. He's also served as Japan's Consul General in Los Angeles, as well as Deputy Vice Minister of Foreign Policy and Deputy Minister for Foreign Affairs. We're delighted that Ambassador Nishida can be with us today. So please join me in welcoming Ambassador Tsuneo Nishida.
CEO of the Foreign Policy Association, Mr. Motoatsu Sakurai, President of the Japan Society, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and of course there are so many friends. Thank you for coming. It's truly an honor for me to be given this opportunity to address you on Japan's engagement with the United Nations in a modern world. Today, this is realized because of wonderful partnership between two distinguished institutions, Japan Society and Foreign Policy Association. Thank you very much for the presence. And of course, thank you, Roger, for your wonderful introduction. and your introduction has reminded me of Kim Il-sung connection. So thank you so much. Before starting my remarks, I'd like to give you one question. How to choose your leader? How to choose your president, prime minister? Well, I mean, not only government, but private corporations. It has been very old, but still very much today's present questions. World is really changing so fast, and the environment surrounding your company, your family, your people is also changing so fast. We need a good leader. We need a wonderful, strong leader. Of course, I have to stress at the same time, owners are always we, people. But still, we have a good person, the commission. So something to do on behalf of us and for us. And probably nobody has a perfect answer to this very difficult question. But when I was in the Soviet Union, I found out that the Soviet Communist Party had a really perfect answer how to choose a leader. If you want to be leader of Soviet Union at the time, you need two talents, qualifications, mentally and also physically. First, it's a simpler part. You have to deliver a very long speech without any interruption, at least a couple of hours. If you are lucky, then you can extend almost half a day. But substance is almost nothing. It's almost torture. But it is the one first, I mean, a qualification for you to be the head of the Soviet regime. Second qualification is a bit harder part. You have to climb up the rainy Muslim in the winter time. Temperature, well, do not surprise, minus 30, minus 30 centigrade. Probably it's almost 10 minus the Fahrenheit. You could stay, salute. Of course, we have to review military parade. This is annual event. You have to climb up, you have to stay, you have a salute, and probably you are invited to make a speech again. And so probably the ceremony lasted a couple hours. Of course, after the ceremony was over, I hope she or she could get access to water. But still, and this is annual event. It means you have to test yourself, I mean, every year. And sometimes you think it's just too much. Then you will find your successor. Very peacefully, very democratic way. That's the way how to choose your perfect leader. So I think we can learn something from this. United Nations today is almost like that. It is always my pleasure to come back to this beautiful facility. Reason again, two. One, this is a facility in order to serve Japan, including Japanese business, Japanese culture, and of course, Japanese people as a whole. That is a good reason for me to come and to make a stop by. But another reason is more realistic. It's very close to my mission. So we are neighbors. Therefore, I have really such a pleasure to really have so many meetings and seminars and events using this wonderful facility. And most of them, I am very humble diplomat, therefore I said most of them, not all events have been so successful. Thank you so much for your collaboration of this Japan society. And of course, audiences are always most important. And last, just a couple of weeks ago, We had also a symposium, one of those many, and the subject matter was abduction. I think many of today's participants are aware of that tragedy. Many Japanese have been kidnapped by TPRK. This is, kind of official naming of one country in terms of the United Nations, TPRK, Democratic Republic of Korea, that is, North Korea, so to speak. North Korea has abducted so many Japanese students, including only one 13 years old junior high school girl. They have abducted for many reasons. They want to teach and train their own spies for them to be performing perfectly as if they are Japanese. Therefore, they need Japanese teachers. They have learned Japanese language, they have learned Japanese habits, and how to speak to, how to behave, such. It's a really difficult task for them, I suppose. Therefore, they need good teachers. But they have, for that purpose, abducted innocent Japanese students. And this is done not by Yakuza or Mafia group, that was done by the country. It is actually terrorism done by the state. So at the time, the seminar was very successful. And I am so happy to see so many people here in order to share 1.5 or 1 hour, time. Share Japan really want to engage with the United Nations in order to cope with the challenges we are really facing in the world of 21st century. The United Nations lives and works in a turbulent world with huge challenges. Not a day goes by in which we don't hear news of the growing death tolls in Syria, nor do the provocative actions by North Korea seem to have any end. Suicide bombs, acts of terrorism have become almost routine in many countries and in many regions. We are getting accustomed to. Even we say, oh, only 100 people killed. That's the reaction. The reality that face today are obviously totally different from what surrounded the United Nations when it was founded in the year of 1945. If we look at the nature of the conflicts around the world, conflict within states, including ones involving non-state actors, have increased dramatically over that time. The recent uproars witnessed in North Africa, Middle East, are all good examples of conflicts of this nature. Furthermore, it's not just the nature of conflict that has changed. The advancement of globalization has presented the world with new and pressing challenges requiring holistic and comprehensive approach. Terrorism, piracy, violation of human rights, issues related to women and youth, and migration. These are only some of the tasks the United Nations, its member states, including Japan, need to address. And of course, on top of that, shifting the balance of political and economic power among member states are another very important aspect that cannot be disregarded. Economic and financial crisis, which started here in the United States, spread to Europe, has become a heavy drag on the influence of developed countries in the United Nations charts. At the same time, emerging and developing countries are gaining an even more significant voice. These countries included not only BRICS, or I mean the next 11, even very small or smaller countries rack their brains to increase their leverage. The LDCs, standing for least developed countries, and Cs, small island developing states, are examples of groups of such developing countries that by gathering their voices together are increasingly stepping into major world stage. I think it is very fair to say the world has become more and more fragmented and multipolar. Well, to be more exact, I have to say non-polar. As we can see, the global landscape is becoming a very complex one. As the most universal representative institution the world has, hopes remain the United Nations can continue to facilitate action through integrated solutions to challenges that we are really every day facing. Japan has maintained a passion for multilateralism and respect for international order since its accession to the United Nations. It was in the year 1956. It has consistently supported the work of the United Nations, even in the face of our own hard times. And not only do we provide a substantial portion of financial contribution on which this organization runs, but we also often take active initiative and the lead in discussion on the various very important issues. Let me now touch upon some of the major engagement by Japan and United Nations, starting with Japan's contribution to the maintenance of peace and stability and the support for social economic development and effort for the protection, promotion of human rights. Of course, preventing armed conflict, keep peace, and rebuild war-torn states remain among the most intractable challenges facing the United Nations. Every year, at least 250,000 people die in interstate armed conflicts. And according to the World Bank, up to $100 billion are spent in conflicts. United Nations has evolved over the years to effectively respond to the new and complex crisis. Peacekeeping operations, PKO, have become more and more robust and multidimensional. The latest example of the evolving response by the United Nations is adoption of the first ever offensive combat force targeted to neutralize and disarm rebel groups in DRC. Democratic Republic of Congo. The cooperation between the United Nations and the regional organizations like Africa Union has also evolved notably. We can witness in the dispatch of AU and UN hybrid operation in Darfur, in Sudan. Furthermore, in an effort to foster integrated strategies for sustainable peace and recovery in the aftermath of armed conflict, the United Nations established a new commission called Peace Building Commission in 2005 under the auspices of both General Assembly and Security Council. In addition to that, the Department for Field Support was created in the year 2007 to manage the logistical aspect of PKO more effectively. How does Japan fit in this process and in these efforts? Throughout its 20-year history in PKO, Japan has dispatched personnel and contingents, troops, to 13 PKO missions around the world, including Timor-Leste, Haiti, and South Sudan. These are only recent examples. In South Sudan, Japanese engineering units are now supporting nation building for the youngest nation, that is South Sudan, and happen to be 193rd member states. It means now United Nations has 193 member states. In order to share lessons learned from its valuable experience as an early peace builder, Japan hosted a seminar here, again at the Japan Society, on evolving roles of engineering units in United Nations peacekeeping operations in last March. Japan has actively engaged in peace building as well. Japan has been a committed member of the PBC since its inception and currently serves as chair of the committees for lessons learned. Japan is also one of the main partners to the Peace Building Fund, contributing approximately $32.5 million. Peace building is, of course, a very long process, not easy one. And you can really be reminded, we have witnessed in not a few cases, holding elections cannot be necessarily destination. It's an even start toward next another conflict. Needless to mention the tragic memories of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Japan is of course strongly committed to disarmament and non-proliferation. In order to urge the international community to continue its untiring effort to realize a world without nuclear weapons, Japan has been leading negotiations for adopting resolutions on this topic at the UN General Assembly on an annual basis since the year of 1994. Last year, the resolution proposed by Japan gathered 99 co-sponsors and supported by 174 member states. Please remember the total number, 193, and supporters of this resolution amount to 174 member states. People are mostly killed, not by weapons of mass destruction like nuclear weapons. People are killed every day and everywhere by conventional weapons. Therefore, we are so happy. A landmark adoption was just achieved on the Arms Trade Treaty, ATT. It's not a victim company. It's another new name of the treaty. This April, the United Nations. As one of the seven co-authors, which started this process 7 years ago, Japan worked strenuously to bridge gaps among member states to agree on a text treaty which will enhance transparency and accountability of international transfer trade of arms. I'm more than happy that arms trade treaty was adopted by an overwhelming majority of member states, including United States, and the signing ceremony will take place very soon here in New York. All UN member states need to be fully involved in effectively implementing UN sanctions, non-proliferation disarmament measures. Proliferators of weapons of mass destruction and conventional arms always seek vulnerable borders. Therefore, national policy and very closely tight network of collaboration among member states are crucial. In this regard, the mission of Japan, together with the mission of Poland and Turkey, regularly organize a series of conferences called Padway Security Roundtable. And many UN diplomats find really great value in stepping outside that UN compound into this beautiful setting and to have interactive exchange of views, not only among diplomats, but with academia, even press, NGOs, and business people. And our mission plan to convene the next session again here at the Japan Society on June the 10th. I would like to see some faces here again in one or two weeks. It would be inappropriate not to touch on the North Korea when talking about disarmament and non-proliferation. Tensions arose really extremely when the North Korea launched a long-range missile in December last year and then conducted nuclear tests in February this year. North Korea's nuclear and missile program posed serious threat to entire international community and must not be treated as only regional problems. Japan strongly urges North Korea to comply with relevant Security Council resolutions and don't conduct another provocative actions. Terrorism continues to be one of the most serious threats to international peace and security. Let me recall and condemn once again the terrorist attack in Algeria, where 10 Japanese citizens were killed, and the latest tragedy at the Boston Marathon. In action to those incidents, Japan has announced plans to further strengthen international counterterrorism measures, support stabilizing the region of the Sahel in Africa, North Africa and the Middle East. And we would like to promote dialogue with Islamic and Arab states. No country is immune from terrorism. Thus, global and tight enforcement of comprehensive and coordinated responses is crucial. Japan has been playing a central role in helping Afghan people rebuild their own country as the second biggest donor after the United States. Last year's Tokyo Conference on Afghanistan has successfully launched a Tokyo framework aiming at the years after international troops will withdraw. I would like to go to the second pillar, that is social and economic development. Social and economic development is another stated pillar of the United Nations. While we have less than 1,000 days until the target date for the achievement of Millennium Development Goals, MDGs, Japan has been working hard to accelerate efforts toward achievement of MDGs through a number of initiatives, including ones especially education and health. At the same time, Japan has substantively contributed to the discussion of the formulation of the development agenda beyond 2015 by organizing an informal policy dialogue group called the Post-MDG Contact Group, as well as by actively participating, supporting the United Nations Development Group in conducting series of thematic and regional consultations with various stakeholders, including civil society, private sectors, and others. Women and youth are expected to play a pivotal role in this inclusive process. And when we're talking about post-2015 agenda, I think the goals must be simple set of packages, goals, clear, simple and measurable. It can really guarantee so what you have done, but you can't. And this is measurable, it means it is monitorable. So that you can follow up, so what is needed. This is, I think, in build process, but that is very much important. We're talking about the 2015 development agenda. Sustainability is a key concept. We can't achieve poverty eradication, which is our ultimate goal in the post-2015 development agenda, without ensuring sustainability. Sustainability was intensively discussed during Rio+20, a landmark conference held last year that focused on green economy in the context of sustainable development, and also the institutional framework for sustainable development. Using this opportunity, Japan launched its Green Future Initiatives, proposing to explore sustainable growth. Climate change is, of course, one of the many major challenges in the context of this sustainability. It continues to be a pressing issue for the international society, and in particular, to the most vulnerable, including small island states. They are threatened. The territory is sinking inch by inch every day. In order to address climate change, negotiation for the establishment of a fair and effective international framework in which every major economy, like US, like China, participates are very crucial. Same time, concerted effort by every member state to reduce greenhouse gas emissions without waiting for the establishment of such new framework are required. As part of Japan's engagement in development, let me also mention TCAD 5. TCAD stands for Tokyo Conference for African Development. The TCAD process was launched in the year 1993, and this year 2013, it means we have already 20-year history. When it was launched, it was the first high level, it's a summit level, policy dialogue framework between African leaders and development partners, including United Nations, World Bank, and other services. Since then, it has evolved and developed into a major framework for the promotion of development in Africa under the principles of ownership and partnership. TCAD 5 is going to be held from this weekend in Yokohama. It's a beautiful city from very close to Tokyo, under the overarching theme, hand in hand with a more dynamic Africa. Third pillar of the United Nations is promotion and protection of human rights. Promoting and encouraging respect for human rights is another major pillar stipulated in the UN Charter. Indurable peace and prosperity is not achievable if such a universal value of the human rights is undermined. Japan is actively engaged in the promotion and protection of human rights as a member of the Human Rights Council for the term to 2013 and 2015. Still today, unfortunately, we are witnessing many grave human rights violations in the world. Japan actively engaged in efforts of the United Nations to address and overcome those situations. One example is, of course, the situation in Syria. From the outset, Japan has been consistently supporting and co-sponsoring the General Assembly and the Human Rights Council resolutions in dealing with this unfortunate situations, address the suffering of every day. Japanese human genocide system has now totaled $80.5 million while addressing the appalling human rights and humanity crisis. International community need to take coordinated action in order to end all violence and bring about Syrian-led political process. Japan will continue to support diplomatic efforts by Mr. Brahimi, Joint Special Representative of the United Nations on OSCE, the League of Arab States. Strongly hopes upcoming International Conference on Syria, so-called Geneva II, will be held and will be held successfully with a view to finding political solution for this crisis. Another example of widespread systematic violation of human rights is, I said before, situation with North Korea. Allow me to underline the graveness of the situation. United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, Ms. Nevi Pillay, stated following, the deplorable human rights situation in DPRK, which in one way or another affects almost the entire population and has no parallel anywhere else in the world, which may amount to crime against humanity. Human rights situation in DPRK, including the abduction issue, is something we really all must address together. For many years, Japan, together with the EU, has introduced resolutions on the human rights situation in DPRK to the United Nations General Assembly on an annual basis. Last March, the Human Rights Council in Geneva adopted establishment of a commission of inquiry on the DPRK human rights situation by consensus. I sincerely hope the commission of inquiry will be successful in this work, and I urge all member states to cooperate with this panel. In addition to country-specific questions, cross-cutting issues are also very much at the heart of the United Nations. Advancement of women, who account for at least half of the world population, is one of the key issues. Number four, the United Nations have been addressing economic, social, political disparities and discriminations against women. And the Father Security Council highlights the gender issue through its thematic debate calling for concrete measures to end violence, discrimination against women. In order to respond to these international calls, Japan has not only incorporated the general perspective of women in its ODA policy, Official Development Assistance Policy, but has also recently announced a new contribution of $4.5 million for programs to prevent sexual violence and support victims in countries such as Libya, Somalia, Central African Republic, and Mali. I have today briefly explained how Japan engages in the three pillars of the United Nations, namely maintenance of peace and stability, development, and protection of human rights. But let's not forget about the UN reform. Different issues I have today touched upon, in fact, all interconnected, and therefore, holistic, coordinated approaches are required. Although initiatives to implement the reform agenda, such as change management team announced by Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, is mostly welcome, the United Nations, like any large organization, public or private, struggles to adapt to new realities in a timely manner. Frustration is mounting. The organization seems to be unable to function effectively as we really expect. Particularly Security Council is one such organ that hasn't changed substantially from its original form despite profound changes in the world. Security Council reform is long, long overdue. It's time for all member states to start real negotiations with a sense of urgency and a spirit of flexibility, but on top of that, spirit of trust. Trust, mutual trust among member states with a view to common future. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope my talk today has provided you with a little bit clearer picture what Japan has been doing and trying to do so. But before concluding, I'd like to refer to two concepts that are of great importance in my view today's world, namely rule of law and human security. Importance of rule of law cannot be overemphasized. In the face of new and complex challenges, rule of law is core principle of governance that ensures justice, stability, and predictability. Japan has continuously believed in the rule of law, contributes to strengthening it. In fact, Japan is supporting major international judicial institutions like International Court of Justice, ICJ, International Criminal Court, ICC, and International Tribunal for the Law of the Sea, ITOS, both not only providing judges, but financial terms. As support to ad hoc tribunals, including the extraordinary chambers in the Court of Cambodia, also shows another good example that Japan believes in the rule of law. In addition, Japan has been making further efforts to provide legal systems and human resources in various developing countries. Rule of law is an essential precondition for lasting peace, stability, and global prosperity. However, we can yet claim rule of law has been fully respected in every corner of the world. It is of particular importance that rule of law is applied in territorial and maritime disputes, of which there are still a number in many parts of the world. I'd like to underscore the foremost principle: we must settle disputes and reestablish order, not by force, but by addressing them based on rule of law. Any attempts of coercion, or I mean intimidation, must not be tolerated. Human security is also a concept particularly relevant to today's global environment. It's a new and developing concept, which focuses on individuals instead of states, and pursues a way to provide individuals better conditions for them to live healthy, dignified, and fulfilling lives they are really entitled. Human security is effective in helping vulnerable people suffering in countries where government very often does not function. By empowering them and their communities who live in free from fear, free from want, and live with dignity. That's the hardcore of this new emerging concept. Japan has been really working on that. Japan has been promoting this concept in United Nations activities through the UN Trust Fund for human security. The adoption of the General Assembly resolution last September, which established a common understanding of the concept, was a major breakthrough to further promote human security. Today's complex and turbulent world does not allow us only simply to be neither optimist nor pessimist. Every and each country, responsible partner of the world, has to cooperate hand in hand to establish just, fair international order and achieve the future we want for the next generation to come. The road toward the goal is long and bumpy. But I believe the United Nations, despite ongoing efforts for this reform, is still currently the most viable vehicle to take us to the desired destination. Thank you so much. Thank you for attention.